stove.
That's a story.
Did you figure it out? Did you get it working?
Well, it went on.
Came on?
Yeah.
We pray for things like that, and especially as we go. So it came on.
Yeah.
Yes. We figured it out. Well, we were talking about it going home. We can't sit down. The burner's burned. The oven shouldn't affect the clock. You said the oven was
the closet and the
clock was wrong. With the oven.
No, they weren't.
No,
we had to work.
Yeah. We had to work then. Two of them.
We were paying our
education. Okay, well, that's good.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
A couple of announcements for us. Praise and Bible study will be tonight at 6. Praise team will meet on Thursday at 6:30. January 24th, our annual congregational meeting. Next Sunday, trustees meet following the worship service. Any other announcements that need to be made? I don't know whether or not or when the decorations will be taken down, but sometime this week, I'm assuming. So.
If not, we'll just enjoy them a little longer.
Disgrace them?
I don't know.
Okay. All right. Other than that, greet one another, and let's praise the Lord. Shall we stand? The insert in your bulletins.
Bind us together, Lord, bind us together with cords that cannot be broken. Bind us together.
Seen them, so I'm.
I told Chris, you come here and look, and people think I'm crazy.
And it wasn't just one, it was a bunch.
Like six of them.
Yeah. So if robins are in your yard, can spring be far away? We can hope, huh? Hope and believe.
That's right.
Anybody else?
Well, I praise the Lord for 2020 and that He was my rock.
Amen.
And I praise the Lord for this church that we did not forsake the gathering. I just praise the Lord for His provisions and His protection.
Amen. Amen.
For the new year, 2021.
And for a new year. Getting things done for God's Son in 2021, right?
Amen.
That's right. That's right. You will hear that on several occasions. Getting things done for God's Son in 2021. Anybody else? Then let's sing number 292. God of grace and God of has passed on, so we can remove him from our list. Are there any additions this morning? Your sister, right, Walter?
Yeah, I have two sisters, but the one's in the nursing home that I was in. Her name's Patty. She named Warner, but she was married one of the boys, but she was bad shape. I heard last night that she's not conscious and she has pneumonia, and her heart rate dropped to like 25.
Okay.
And not for sure if she's going to last much longer. She might have already been gone for all I know, but Lisa, say a prayer for her. I did last night and
okay.
Do it again today.
Anybody else?
Ron Heinwald's healing.
Yeah.
He lost his brother and he has two in-laws that are in the hospital that they don't expect to live with COVID.
Anyone else? Let's pray. Father, we give you thanks and praise as we intercede for these on our prayer list.
Yes.
Father, we know that nothing's impossible with you.
That's right. Thank you.
And today,
Jesus.
Father, we just ask by the power of your Holy Spirit that your presence would be experienced in the lives of these that we're praying for this morning.
Yep.
Father, you can be in more than one place at one time.
That's right.
In fact, you can be everywhere all the time.
Yep.
In fact, you are.
Yes. Praise the
Lord. The psalmist said, if I climb to the highest mountain, you're there.
Yep.
If I go to the depths of the sea, you are there.
Yep.
So, Father, we know without a shadow of a doubt that you are already in those rooms with these individuals.
Yes.
But, Father, we want your will to be manifest in those situations.
Yep.
Father, of everything else, that Jesus be Lord. The enemy's already defeated.
Yep.
Father, just quicken their faith this morning just to believe that you are and that you are a rewarder of those who seek you.
Yep.
Father, help us this day, even as we intercede for them, to remember that as we agree, as touching and agreeing, Father, that your will be done. Father, sometimes it's not the way exactly that we want it to be done, but we know one thing. Your will ultimately be done.
Yep.
Because Jesus is Lord and he is the soon coming King.
Yep.
Father, may he be that soon coming King for each of these on our prayer list this morning. Father, especially Ron's family, Father, just be their comforter today. And for Patty, Father, just surround her with your grace.
Yep.
Father, if this is the time for you to call her home, then Father, take her. But Father, above everything, let her know and feel and sense this very moment that Jesus is in control.
Yes. Thank
you. So Father, we just thank you and praise you as we lift up each one of these requests this morning. We lift up our service personnel and all those first responders, that the power of your presence would be with them, Father. Mm-hmm. That your Holy Spirit, even now, would quicken to their heart the reality that you're there.
Yep.
Those who don't know you, that this might be that day that they say, Jesus, be Lord of my life.
That's right.
Father, we give you thanks for our first responders. We thank you for our military. And we just ask that you put a hedge of protection around them, especially those who are in harm's way today. We thank you for their willingness to serve. May they find Jesus as their strength today. We pray for the peace of Jerusalem, that both Jew and Arab would come to recognize Jesus as not only the Messiah of Israel, but the Savior of the world.
Amen.
Father, their Savior, their peace bringer. Because, Father, that's where peace truly lies. Father, we lift up our nation. We lift up the turmoil that's going to take place this week.
Yes.
Father, we know that this world's in a mess.
Yes.
We know this nation's in a mess.
Yes.
But we still know Jesus is Lord.
That's right.
Father, that the leadership would turn once again to recognize and realize that to not follow Jesus is for our doom.
That's right.
Father, help them understand that you're the righteousness. You're the way that we need to go. You're the one that can only bring true unity in this nation.
Yep.
And so, Father, by your Holy Spirit, get a hold of our leadership and help them come to grips with the reality that you are still God and you still have a plan for us.
Yep.
Father, in all these things, we give you praise. We give you glory. And it's all because of Jesus, in whose name we pray the prayer he's taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Honey, I want to share something. I wasn't here last week to share. But keep praying for these people that's in the hospital, because my aunt and her daughter both were in ICUs with this COVID. And my aunt, they had talked to her about putting her on a ventilator, and she said no. She said, if it's God's going to take me home, it's going to take me home. But I prayed with her, and we put them on the prayer chain, and we put both of them on. And within 2 days of us putting them on the prayer chain, both of them ended up going home.
Right.
So that's the power of God and the power of prayer.
That's right.
I just happened to think about that. I hadn't shared that. And I just want to encourage people, do not
stop praying, because God does hear our prayers.
Yep.
Amen. He's eager to answer.
Yep.
But I also have to pray His will.
Praise the Lord. Let's receive our morning tithes and offerings. And let's praise God in the words of the doxology. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Giving into your kingdom. Use these gifts for your glory. Touch somebody's life for Jesus. And we give you the praise in His name. Amen.
Amen.
Before you sit down, number 284. We are one. Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit. We are one in the Lord. And we pray that all unity may one day be restored. And they'll know we are Christians by our love. By our love. Yes, they'll know we are Christians by our love. States, Christ gave His life for you. in order to give his life to you so that he can live his life through you. That's the key going into 2021. God has a plan for his body.
Yep. That's right.
And we're going to take a look at that plan this morning. First of all, we need to understand above anything else that his body, like our own lives, must operate with faith. God's call for his body and for us as individuals is to operate our lives with faith. With faith. When you came in here this morning, you sat down on the pew with faith.
That's right.
Believing it holds you.
Yep.
Probably didn't even give it a thought.
That's right.
You went out and you stuck your key in the ignition this morning and you turned it on expecting there to be an engine under there. And there was. Sometimes we operate with faith and don't even recognize it. When you got up this morning, you stepped out of your bed onto the floor expecting it to be there.
Yep.
Were any of you surprised that it wasn't? Or that it was?
If it wasn't, I probably wouldn't be here.
The whole reality is that we do operate on with faith. The problem is that too often our faith is directed in the wrong direction.
That's right. What we see.
I want us to understand something this morning. Our responsibility is to operate with faith, not in the coronavirus inoculations, not in the government, not in the $600 or whatever is going to come across our path. We operate with faith in God.
Amen.
And the church needs to stand stronger than ever before in this time and age.
That's right.
To operate with faith in Him.
Yep.
Amen.
And Him alone.
That's right.
Romans 12. For by grace given me, I say to every one of you, do not think of yourself more highly than you ought, but rather think of yourself with sober judgment in accordance with the measure of faith God has given you.
Yep.
I want us to understand this morning, you have been given the measure of faith.
Amen.
That's
right.
It's there. God has measured to you a portion of faith. Not just any faith, but God's kind of faith.
That's right.
The faith of God he has put in us.
Yep.
Look what it says, the measure of faith God has given. And so we operate with faith in what God has done for us already.
Yep.
We can't even come to God without His faith working through us.
That's right.
With the Holy Spirit quickening our faith to recognize and realize we cannot do it on our own.
That's right.
No one can. That's why when I've shared this before, but it fits so well. This is why it's so important when we went into the jails to preach and to share. In the jails, one of the things that Frog always said was he'd have everybody stand up and say the same thing. Jesus, we need you.
That's right.
Yes, we do.
Jesus, we need you.
Yep.
That's where our faith needs to be placed. In the God who has loved us so much that He's given us Jesus in whom we need every day.
That's right. Thank you, Jesus.
The measure of faith. And that's why it was interesting later on, as we'll see, when the apostles asked Him to increase their faith, He had an answer for them. But I want us to look at Hebrews 11 first. Without faith, it's impossible to please God.
That's right.
Because anyone who comes to Him must believe that He exists and that He rewards those who earnestly seek Him.
That's right.
That's faith. With faith that believes not only that God exists, but that he rewards those who really seek after him.
Yep.
Earnestly desire him. Put their faith in him. Trusting him in every aspect of our lives. Not worrying about anything else, but God is our focus. God is our answer. God rewards those who seek him. God rewards those, as he says elsewhere, who hunger and thirst for his righteousness. God is a rewarder of faith. Not just the faith that he's put in us, but the faith that we put back into him as we walk with faith, by faith, into this year, 2021. By faith, with faith. With faith. And then Luke 17. The apostle said to the Lord, increase our faith. And he replied, if you have faith as small as a mustard seed, you can say to this mulberry tree, be uprooted and planted in the sea, and it will obey you.
Yep.
Notice something that Jesus says, very interesting. If you have faith. Didn't we just say that everyone has been given the measure of faith?
Yep.
So he is saying to them, it's not the amount of faith that you have. If you have faith the size of a mustard seed, all you need to have is just a little bitty piece of faith, and it depends on where you plant it that makes the difference. Our responsibility is to sow our faith into God and in God's direction, God's will, God's plan.
Right.
Our job is to do it God's way, and if we plant our seed of faith in him, he will produce marvelous things.
Yep.
If you go on and read that scripture from Luke, it says that that's the smallest of all seeds, and yet it grows into a huge bush that the birds flock to.
Yep. Mighty.
And if we want to see the birds of this area flock to Jesus, we've got to sow that faith into God. We've got to stand firm that God is the answer.
That's right.
God has a plan.
That's right.
God has a purpose, and God is going to work it out for his glory. I don't know when Jesus is coming back, but Jesus is coming back.
That's right.
Yep. I don't know whether he's going to call us out of this world in what some call the rapture, or whether we will die and go to meet him. But one thing I know, he's coming.
That's right.
He's yep. coming.
That's right.
And one day, God will clap. And when God claps, remember the old song? He's got the whole world in his hands. And one day he's going to clap. And the way this old world's going right now, it could be tomorrow.
That's right.
Even so, Lord, come quickly.
Yep.
But the reality is that until he comes, we have to plant our faith in him.
That's right. Him alone.
And trust in him.
Yep.
And believe in his direction and purpose for our lives.
Right.
We operate with faith. The faith he's given us, planted into the soil of his grace, his mercy, and his love. Secondly, we operate by faith in the greatness of God.
Mm-hmm.
Luke 1:37. As Elizabeth speaks to Mary carrying Jesus. For nothing is impossible. I'm sorry, when the angel speaks, for nothing is impossible with God.
That's right.
Nothing
Thank you,
is
Jesus.
Impossible with God. So we operate by faith in this fact, nothing is impossible with God. So if we're saying that nothing is impossible, then we're also saying everything is possible.
That's right.
Or anything is possible. Or all things are possible.
That's right.
You see, it's so important for us to not just simply focus on the negative, that nothing is impossible, but the reality is that all things are possible.
That's right. Thank you,
we
Jesus.
We need to operate by the faith in the greatness of God.
Yep.
Oh, that doesn't mean everything's going to go our way.
Yep.
Hello.
That's right.
But if God be for us, says Paul, who could be against us?
That's right.
The enemy's going to attack. The enemy's going to attack. The enemy still wants to steal, kill, and destroy.
Yep.
The enemy wants to attack us. And the enemy will put more of his effort against the church than anybody else. That's why we have so many so-called churches that aren't churches at all.
That's right.
They don't believe the whole Bible. They just go through the motions. But the reality is that our responsibility is to believe God, period.
That's right.
God says it, that settles it.
That's right.
And eventually, God will settle it. I guarantee.
Yep.
Our responsibility is to be true to what God has given us, to operate with faith and operate by faith in His greatness. Look at Philippians. I know how to be abased. I know how to abound, Paul says. Everywhere in all things I've learned both to be full and to be hungry, both to abound and to suffer need. And then the great phrase is oftentimes taken out of context. I can do all things through He who empowers me.
Yep.
Oh, now in most of your New King James and other translations, it will oftentimes say, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. But the real translation is, I can do all things through He who empowers me.
That's right.
Empowers me. Not just strengthens me in the struggle, but empowers me in the struggle. I'm not just going through the motions. I'm living with the power of God coursing through me to overcome all of those adversities that He's talking about.
Right.
I know how to be abased. I know how to be in want. I know how to struggle. But I know one thing. I'm going to handle it because God empowers me.
That's right.
And I'm going to go through because God empowers me. And nothing's going to stand in my way because God's power is with me. Hallelujah.
That's right. Praise the Lord.
We need to stand on the promises of God and live by the faith of His Word. If He says it, we need to accept it, believe it, and walk with it.
That's right.
That's operating by faith.
Yep.
Let the devil do what the devil wants to do. He can't win.
That's right.
The cross has already declared the victory.
That's right.
The tomb has already declared the battle's over.
Thank you, Jesus.
That doesn't mean we don't have those skirmishes, because we do. We fight them every day. But the reality is, I can do all things through He who empowers.
That's right.
By faith, taking that little faith that I might have and putting it where it belongs, in the mighty power of God alone.
Yep.
Hallelujah.
That's right.
Get a praise the Lord.
That's right. Praise the Lord.
And now we operate by His plan. Ephesians chapter 4. Be completely humble and gentle. Be patient, bearing with one another. I want to stop there for a moment. Be completely humble and gentle. Sometimes we think of somebody being humble and gentle being Casper Milk Toast. How many of you heard the word Casper Milk Toast? Anybody else around here? Well, in our neck of the words, Casper Milk Toast means somebody who's just a weak-kneed chicken liver, and you know what else could go along with that.
Soggy when wet.
That has nothing to do with what these words are. When He says become completely humble and gentle, being patient, bearing with one another, He's simply saying take on Jesus.
That's right.
Amen.
Yep.
Taking on Jesus. Wasn't Jesus gentle and humble?
Yes.
In fact, the Bible tells us He humbled Himself and became flesh.
That's right.
He humbled Himself and He was nailed to a tree because of it. He humbled Himself, leaving all of glory. He humbled Himself to be here with us. Our responsibility is not to be Casper Milquetoast, but be humble with one another, gentle with one another. In fact, up there earlier, it talks about being humble when we're talking about the faith that God's given us. Being humble. Not thinking that we're anything great, but recognizing that we have a great God, and humility trusts Him.
Right.
Humility trusts Him. Patience trusts Him. Bearing with one another in love, trusting Him to work out all of our situations. You know, my friends, you all have come across people who aren't very loving. and aren't very lovable. Hello?
That's right.
Am I saying right? Huh? Huh? Yeah, some of them have been in the church. Hello? But the reality is that our responsibility is not to be in judgment. Our responsibility is, as Paul writes, be completely humble, gentle, be patient, bearing with one another in love.
That's right.
Bearing with one another. That means putting up with a lot of stuff. Anybody that's married already knows what that means. Hello?
Yep.
No, Deborah, don't say too much. But the reality is that we put up with stuff just simply because we have two people living in the same household. Yeah, it happens. Why? Because we still have our own personalities, our own belief systems, even though they aren't always lining up perfectly with one another. Bearing with one another. Then he makes this comment. Make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. Make every effort. You see, I want us to understand something very clearly. It's our job. This is our job, not God's job. God's already made it possible for us to do this, to make every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. God's already given us that. God's given us that power.
That's right.
God's given it. That's our job. Now, we have to do it. Because there is, even as we sang this morning, there is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope, as you were called by one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is over all and through all and in all. But to each one of us, grace has been given as Christ apportioned.
Yep.
Grace has been given as Christ is apportioned. Some of us need more grace than others. And our job, maintaining the unity of the fellowship of believers, our job is to recognize that. Some people are graced a great deal.
Yep.
Some people need a lot of grace. Some people just simply accept grace and live that way. Our responsibility is to recognize that each one of us, no matter how much grace we have, is God's gift.
That's right.
God has gifted us with His grace. Now, His grace is also translated later on into His gifts, His grace gifts, His charismata. We have also been gifted by that way, and we'll see that in a moment. But verse 11, and now I'm going to get into really what I wanted to preach about this morning. So I hope your roast is on simmer. It was He who gave some to be apostles, some to be prophets, some to be evangelists, some to be pastors and teachers. And there's a reason why He gave the church these offices. And here it comes. Number one, to prepare God's people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up. My job is to help us, is to prepare us for works of service so that the body will be built up. For the body. These ministries are for the body. I want us to understand it. These ministries are not for the world. These ministries are not for us to go out and do those things out there. Our job is to equip you, the body. The whole body. Equip us so that the body might grow, be built up, be encouraged, be strengthened, become whole. My job is to challenge each of us to believe that God has something greater for you to do than you could ever imagine. My job is to challenge everyone, to challenge the church as a whole, to begin to stretch out and begin to believe that God wants to enlarge our tent.
Yep.
And our tent posts. God wants to enlarge us. God doesn't want to shrink us. Number two, until we all reach the unity in the faith and in the knowledge of the Son of God. Until we all finally come to that point in which we, in faith, agree. Come to unity. Now that's not unanimity. That doesn't mean that we all agree with everything, but we come together in unity because we grow together as a unit, recognizing differences so that we can grow even further. You see, like the proverb says, iron against iron. So a man against man rubs against one another so that we can grow in the grace that God has for us. Growing in His knowledge, growing in the truth, growing in the direction that God has for us to go. So that we can, three, become mature, attaining, look at this, the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Mm-hmm. The whole measure of the fullness of Christ. And my friends, I want us to understand so clearly, we can't do it individually, we do it corporately. It's a body thing. It's not an individual thing. We cannot, as individuals, grow into the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. We do that, not I do that. It's we that grow, we that mature, we that grow into that whole measure of the fullness of Christ so that we can believe God for anything. We can believe God for everything. We can believe God that nothing is impossible with Him. We can believe with God that all things are possible with Him. Hallelujah. That whole measure of the fullness of Christ. Number four, then we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching, by the cunning and craftiness of men in their deceitful schemes. My friends, he puts that in there for a very, very definite reason. In the early church, there were all kinds of people doing all kinds of stupid stuff. The church has gone through all kinds of transitions. The church has gone through all kinds of things, all kinds of challenges to the very core of our faith. As I said, some denominations even believe, number one, Mary was not a virgin. Number two, Jesus probably didn't really die. Number three, the tomb might not be empty because of resurrection. Yeah, being tossed to and fro by all this wind of doctrine, man's teachings. And too often we get caught up in man's teachings and in man's direction for the church. And we fail to follow God's plan, God's purpose, God's direction, and God's powerful, powerful resurrection for His church. I don't believe God has called the church to die yet. We're not at the end of the church era. Some people say we're in post-Christianity. We've been in post-Christianity since Jesus was raised from the dead.
That's right.
We've been living there. It's time for us to recognize that the church isn't dead, the Word isn't dead, Jesus isn't dead, and it's time for the church to wake up and come to grips with the reality that God has a plan and He's not through with us yet. Hallelujah. That's right.
Yeah. Praise the Lord.
No longer tossed to and fro. No longer accepting this man's word or that man's word. Trusting the Word of God. I challenge everybody, everywhere I've ever been, I challenge, if I'm wrong, you show me. I want to know if I'm wrong. I want to know so that I can grow too. But if I'm right, we better get on with it. We better be doing it. No longer tossed to and fro by men's craftiness and their own scheme. Instead, speaking the truth in love. And notice this. Speaking the truth in love, we will in all things grow up. Isn't it strange that after almost 2,000 years, that word still is for us today. Grow up. Grow up. Grow up. Quit being kids. Quit doing stupid stuff. Grow up.
grow up in what God has for us. I mean, I know of places, I know of churches who get so upset because somebody changes the color of the carpeting. Or they change the hymn. Sometimes, my friends, people get so upset because we've lost the vision of what Christ wants to do with the church. Grow us up. Grow us up. So that we begin to believe that if God says it, and that's for me, then that's for me. If God says it, that's for me. Into Him who is the head. We grow up into Him. We grow up into what He wants us to do. We grow up into His direction and purpose for our life. We grow up into Him. And we begin to focus our life on Jesus. How can I? How can I? How can we be more like You in our communities?
Yep.
In our families? How can we be more like You? Show us, Lord. Help us grow up in all things into You, into the head. Verse 16, from Him the whole body, from Him, from the head, the whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament, grows, and builds itself up in love. It grows. Notice something very simple. Very simple. I love the way Paul writes. The whole body, joined and held together by every supporting ligament. That's you and me. We're the supporting ligaments. We don't grow separate from that. Muscles don't hold together on bones without the tendons and the ligaments holding it together. Muscles don't hold together properly without ligaments holding them together, making them function in the proper way. Our responsibility is to recognize that from Him, the whole body grows and grows up because we are supporting one another, encouraging one another, loving one another, and that builds ourselves up. We are built up by the love that God has given us for one another. We love one another. We care for one another. We weep with those who weep. We rejoice with those who rejoice. We build up in love. But notice, as, or because each part does its work. We can't grow without each part doing its work. We can't grow expecting the pastor to do what you're supposed to be doing. I've already told you what the pastor is supposed to do. That's my job, is to train us, equip us. The body's job is to do it. All of us together to do it. Each one doing its part. Don't know what your part is? Ask Him. And be very open to be ready for it. The heart that really wants to do what God wants them to do God's way, He'll show us. In fact, chances are He's already shown us. You know? What's the one thing that we would love to do for God? What's the one thing that I'd just love to do for God? Chances are that's what He's called you to do. Find a way. Come to me, I'll help you. Help you grow. Help you find out more clearly. That's my job. But we have to do it together. Together. You see, that's why we sang the songs that we sang this morning early. That's why we sang the hymns that we're singing today. Because it takes a body, not an individual, to bring the kingdom in. It takes the body focusing. It takes the body wanting to function the way God wants us to do. If we really want to reach our community, it takes the body to do it. Each individual doing its part as part of the body of Christ. 1 Corinthians in conclusion, chapter 12. Now there are a diversity of gifts, the same Spirit. Differences of ministries, same Lord. There are diversities of activities, but it's the same God who works all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to each one for the profit of all the rest. God has already given you a gift. God has given you a ministry. God has given you a work to do for the rest of the body. For the rest of the body. If each person does their part, then the body, joined with all of its ligaments doing its job, joined together in unity, speaking the truth in love, and growing up into the head, which is Christ. God's plan, with faith, by faith, following His will, doing it His way, for His glory, and for our growth in His grace. Pray with me. Thank you, Father, for your word.
Yes.
Thank you, Father, for your challenge to us today. Thank you, Father, and help us to operate with faith and by faith, trusting that you are the one who can work all things for your glory through us. Thank you that you've chosen us to do that work, to touch lives around us. Thank you that you've empowered us by the faith you've given us to do those things that would give you the praise and glory. Thank you, Father, for your promise to reward us in so many ways as we just step out in faith and do it for your glory. Thank you, Lord, for your body. Thank you, you're not through with the church. Thank you, Father, that there is a new revival yet to come. Thank you, Father. Thank you, that that will include us as we trust you and do your bidding. For the sake of the body, for the sake of the kingdom, and in the glorious, wonderful name of Jesus, our head. Amen.
Amen.
Let us sing. Let us break bread together in your bulletins. Shall we stand?
Let us break bread together in the Lord. Let us break bread together in the Lord. Sharing in His brokenness and receiving blessedness. Let us pray.
Again, as we participate today, there are two cups. Take one each, one with bread in it and one with the juice in it, as it is being passed to you. Let us pray. Father, thank you for these gifts of your grace, these gifts of body broken and blood spilt. Thank you that you are here present in these elements as we partake of them. And Father, help us this day renew our relationship with you in a special way as we partake of your brokenness and your poured outness for us, for your forgiving love to us. Help us, O Father, this day vow afresh and anew to live for you as you lived and died for us. Thank you, Jesus, and it's in your great and wonderful name. Amen.
Amen.
On the night in which he was betrayed, Jesus took bread, and after he gave thanks, he gave it to his disciples, and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body broken for you. As often as you eat it, remember me." In the same way also, after supper, he took a cup, and after he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. As often as you drink it, remember me." Take and eat the body of Christ broken for you. And take and drink the blood of Christ shed for your sins. Would you stand for a blessing? May the body of Christ and his precious blood strengthen and preserve you in true faith and to life everlasting. Go forth as the body of Christ for a needy world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Love one another.